So I'm going to talk about work that's joint with Xin Zhu. And let me set up the situation. So we're going to be looking just in R3. So I have Euclidean three-dimensional space, and I'm going to start out with some surface of some genus that's embedded in R3. So let's call this surface sigma 0, which is an embedded surface with some genus. So it's closed, so a closed embedded surface. Okay? And we're going to evolve this surface by the mean curvature flow. So let's evolve sigma 0 by the mean curvature flow. Okay, so what that means is I'm going to move each point on the surface in a proportional in the normal direction to the mean curvature at that point. So let's see, the picture is, if that's my surface, I'm going to be deforming it sort of inward here, okay? And the points where the curvature, where the mean curvature is larger, like here, are going to be moving much faster. Okay, so that's the mean curvature flow. And so now I have a one-parameter family, sigma sub t. So what do we know about this situation? The first, you might hope that this flow would exist for a long time. But unfortunately, no matter what surface you start with, you're going to hit a singularity in finite time. Okay, and if you've never seen mean curvature flow, I'll just explain why that is. You could enclose that surface in a round ball. Okay, mean curvature flow on a round ball will just shrink in finite time to a point. And so by the time that ball has shrunk, this surface inside of it also has to shrink and become extinct. So there's going to be a lot of singularities for the mean curvature flow, no matter what surface we start with. So the point is we want to understand the singularity. So Huiskin, so he proved that by rescaling about a singularity, one produces a self-shrinking solution to the mean curvature flow. So what does that mean? So it means a one-parameter family of surfaces, now I call them lambda, so it's defined now for negative time, from negative infinity up to zero. Okay, so we get a self-shrinking solution, which is just this one surface, sigma minus one, that is shrinking via homothetes as time goes up to zero, which is, let's say, a singular time. But I'm not done, so it's not just any such surface, it's also where this lambda sub one satisfies the self-shrinker equation. So lambda sub minus 1 solves the self-shrinker equation. Okay, which I'll write it down. So it's the mean curvature vector is the position vector dotted with the normal vector divided by 2. So this is the self-shrinker equation. So it's an elliptic PDE. Okay, let me give some equivalent forms of that equation. So this equation, and then I'll give some examples of what these shrinkers can look like. So the star is equivalent to the surface gamma sub minus one solving, sort of being a critical point for the Gaussian area functional. Okay, and that functional, which for some reason we call f, not g, is of some surface. We just integrate along the surface the Gaussian weight, like this. Okay? So for any surface, closed, whatever, you could look at this functional. The critical points are precisely those surfaces which are solving the self-shrinker equation. And when you shrink those via homothetes, you produce the singularities of the mean curvature flow. There's another equivalent form. So equivalently, the self-shrinker equation is equivalent to lambda sub minus 1, sorry, gamma sub minus 1 being a minimal surface. In not the usual metric in R3, but in a conformally changed metric. So in this Gaussian, so it's conformal to the Euclidean metric, but it has this weight here. Okay. So singularities of the mean curvature flow are sort of modeled by minimal surfaces in a different metric. Okay. Any questions about so far? So let me give some examples, because the examples will make, hopefully, things clear. Okay. So what is the first example? First example, so these are examples of self-shrinkers. So the first example is, I look in R3, and these are just planes through the origin. So P, a plane through the origin. Okay. And what is the Gaussian area of this guy, of the plane? Well, it's normalized so that the Gaussian area of a plane is equal to 1. Okay. And the plane is a critical point for this Gaussian area functional. So when I gave this talk once, Burkhard complained that this is not actually self-shrinking under the mean curvature flow, right? It's sort of not moving under the mean curvature flow. It's staying the same. But we still call it a self-shrinker because it satisfies the self-shrinker equation. Okay. So that's sort of one important example. Another important example is, so this is the sphere of radius 2 about the origin. So just a sphere about the origin. And what kind of singularity model is this? Well, if my initial surface sigma 0 was a convex body and you ran the mean curvature flow, it would become more and more round as you run the flow until it eventually becomes, so under the mean curvature flow, this would get more and more round, and eventually you would see a sphere, which is asymptotically shrinking. When you rescale, you would see just this spherical singularity. Okay, so this is the singularity model that occurs when convex bodies shrink. Okay, the third most important example are cylinders. So they have a special radius. So it's the radius square root of 2 across R. Okay, and these are again cylinders about the origin. Okay, so under the mean curvature flow, right, the cylinder is just shrinking by homothetes until it reaches a line at t equals 0. And how do these arise as singularities? Well, you could almost see in the picture I drew, you could see that between the two genus 1 parts, there's going to be a neck pinch that happens, potentially. So if a neck pinch is forming, you have something like looking like this. The neck pinch is forming. When I blow up around that singularity, I will see the cylinder, which is self-shrinking. So those are the three most important singularities. Let me tell you what the area, what the Gaussian area of these guys is. So the Gaussian area of this special sphere, which I'll write with a little star, because it has radius 2, it's a little bit less than 1.5. So it's 1.49 something. Okay, and the cylinder, its area is a little bit bigger than 1.49. So it's 1.51 something. Okay, and you could think of the Gaussian area of the singularity model as telling you how complicated the singularity is, right? The simplest one is just the plane, which is not even really a singularity model, right? And then these other guys are a little bit higher. Okay. So before going on, let me just make an analogy that's sort of the central analogy of this talk. Imagine we just have a minimal variety in Euclidean space. So this is just minimal. A hypersurface, but it could be singular. Okay, and now let's just pick a point in the surface, pick a singular point. Okay, so a singular point. We know by the monotonicity formula that when you rescale around the singular point, you produce a minimal cone, right? So we could look at the tangent cones at that point. This is tangent cones. Okay, and because it's a cone, right, it's determined by its link in the sphere. Okay, so these are determined by a minimal surface in the sphere. Okay, so sort of the analogy is that singularities of mean curvature flow, right, are modeled by these minimal surfaces in this funny metric over here. Okay, in the same way that singularities of minimal surfaces are sort of determined by minimal surfaces in this round sphere. Okay, so there's an analogy between minimal surfaces in the sphere and minimal surfaces in this Gaussian metric. And what I'm going to be talking about really is the analog to the Willmore conjecture for minimal surfaces in the sphere in the Gaussian setting. So, any questions? Yes.
How does the minimal surface there look like for the cylinder?
Say it again, sorry.
How does the minimal surface there look for the cylinder?
So the cylinder is the minimal surface.
So that cylinder is the minimal surface for that.
For the exactly, yeah.
Okay.
Yeah. So, yeah. Okay. So we saw that self-shrinkers are critical points for this functional, this Gaussian area functional. What about the second variation? So what can we say about instability and so forth? So second variation. Right, so here's a self-shrinker. So I'll just write SS for self-shrinker. What we could do, as Laurent did in his talk, we could look at the second derivative of the Gaussian area as I deform the surface in some direction normal to the surface. Okay, so here's my function phi defined on the surface. I look at the second derivative. We know that the first derivative is going to be zero because it's a critical point. And it's sort of, for people who work in minimal surfaces, you won't be shocked that what you produce here is a second order differential operator. Okay, so this is a second order differential operator. Okay, and we could look at the negative eigenvalues, the directions to decrease area, Gaussian area of a self-shrinker. Okay, so it has some number of negative eigenvalues. Number of negatives. Okay. So what are the facts? So the facts about the second variation. First fact proved by Colding-Ilmanen-Minicozzi is that all self-shrinkers are unstable. Okay, so just like in the sphere, right, the round sphere, there are no stable minimal surfaces. The same thing is true in this Gaussian metric. There are no stable locally area minimizing shrinkers. Okay, and there are four instabilities that are always present. So I'll tell you what the four functions are. So for any, if I pick any point in R3, and I apply the operator L to the dot product of the vector with the normal vector, then I get, this is a negative eigenvalue. Okay, so this is a three-parameter family. Okay, and there's a fourth. If I apply it to the position vector dotted with the normal vector, I also get a negative eigenvalue. Okay. So what are these geometrically? These correspond to translating the surface in space. So you have your self-shrinker. Any translation up, down, you know, the three will give an instability potentially. Okay, and this corresponds to homothety. This is just shrinking taking the self-shrinker and moving it down as we had up here by that relation. Right? So for instance, when you do that for the cylinder, what happens? It just becomes a cylinder that's inside the old cylinder, shrinking to a line. Okay? So these are four instabilities that are always present. So one thing we could do is, let's see. Right. Okay, and the third fact I'm going to need is that Colding-Ilmanen-Minicozzi also showed that if you have a self-shrinker, if is a self-shrinker, okay, and the index of the shrinker is less than or equal to 4, then the shrinker is either the plane, the special S2, or the cylinder. Okay, so self-shrinkers of low index are classified. Yes?
The plane has index 4?
Sorry? So, yeah, I want to go through them with the index of all these guys now. So what about the plane? Well, there are two translations on the plane that are not going to move the plane much, right? Not going to move it at all, just move by diffeomorphism, right? So that is not a normal deformation, so that does not count. There is the normal guy. You could take the plane and move it normally, right? That will move the image of the plane. Okay, so there's one. And if you move by homotheti, well, you're just pushing, you're shrinking the plane. It doesn't. So this has index 1. In fact, it has nullity, right? Because there's a two-parameter family of these guys by rotating the angle of the plane. What about the sphere? So let's see. So the sphere, what's the index of the sphere? Well, all the translations, right, all three don't preserve the sphere. So there's at least 3. And the homotheti also doesn't preserve the sphere. So there's 4. There are 4 here. And what about the cylinder? Well, one translation doesn't do anything, right? And so I know it's index 3. Okay, so these are the only guys that have low index. Okay, and if you've studied the Willmore problem, there's an analogous theorem called Urbano's theorem that's used there. Okay. Let's see. Okay, so the backboard doesn't go up, right? Okay. So I have to. So now comes the main main definition of the talk. So Colding-Ilmanen-Minicozzi they define the entropy for any surface. So this doesn't necessarily have to be a self-shrinker in R3. And what is the definition? So the definition is the entropy of a surface is the supremum over all translations in space and all dilations or scalings of the Gaussian area applied to the surface that's translated and then scaled. Okay, so for any surface, I look at this four-parameter family, I take the soup. So this is not a talk on mean curvature flow, and I'm not going to give the full heuristics about why they introduced this. But one reason is that because the singularities have all these instabilities, this is sort of modding out by those instabilities. And those instabilities of translation and dilation, they have to do with the instability of where the singularity occurs in space and time. Okay, so let that marinate. I mean, I don't exactly know what it means, right? I mean, let's see.
Can you say that again?
Yeah. So this is, so we're kind of modding out by the instability of where the singularity happens in space and time. Let that just be a. Let me know. I'll show you how it's useful in the mean curvature flow. Okay. So what are the important points of this entropy? Well, this is supposed to be like Perelman's entropy in some way. So what are the points? So the entropy is decreasing along the mean curvature flow. Okay, that's one great fact. Another great fact is that the entropy is invariant is invariant under dilations and rescalings. Okay. Another fact is that, so if a surface is, if I start with a self-shrinker, if sigma is a self-shrinker, then the soup is attained when there's no translation, when t equals 0 and s is equal to 1. In other words, the entropy of a self-shrinker is the same thing as its area. Okay. So the only one of these that's totally obvious is number 2. Because by definition, we defined it as a soup over all translations and so forth. So certainly it has to be invariant. Okay. Right. So one consequence of all of this entropy is that if I start out with some entropy of a surface and run the mean curvature flow, the entropy of the singularity model I see has to be less than the entropy that I started with, right? Because as I go along the flow, the entropy is decreasing, okay? And then as I start blowing up around a singularity, because of this invariance, the entropy is not changing. So I will. So sort of the entropy is controlling the kinds of singularities you can see later on in the flow, right? So if I start with something with entropy below the cylinder, I can never see the cylinder as a singularity model when I run the mean curvature flow. Okay. Let me now state a theorem. So this is a theorem of Colding-Ilmanen-Minicozzi-White. So they proved that if I have a surface in R3, which is a self-shrinker and compact, okay, then the entropy, then the Gaussian area, or the entropy, it's the same thing for self-shrinkers, is bigger or equal to the Gaussian area of the self-shrinking two-sphere. Okay. So if we were going to draw sort of a line of singularity models, here's the plane happening at 1. Here is 1.49, which is the self-shrinking two-sphere. And a little bit above is 1.451, which is the cylinders. Okay, so they proved that if you're compact and a self-shrinker, you lie above the sphere.
Are there some easy examples of that, not the two-sphere? Are there compact self-shrinkers?
Are there compact self-shrinkers? So yeah, so there is a torus discovered by Anganent. It's like a torus of rotation that would have to have entropy bigger than the two-sphere. I didn't say this, but there are not a lot of examples of self-shrinkers. So for compact, it's really the sphere and those guys of Anganent. Okay, so this is the theorem that they proved, and they made two conjectures. So they made the first conjecture is that if sigma is a self-shrinker and it's non-flat, then the entropy or the area is bigger or equal to the two-sphere. In other words, the non-compact self-shrinkers, like the cylinder, are all going to occur above the self-shrinking two-sphere. And they made a second conjecture. They conjectured that if sigma is a surface, this is just any surface, is a closed surface, then the entropy of the surface is bigger or equal to the entropy of the self-shrinking two-sphere. So one of these follows from the other. Let me see if I remember which way. So if you knew conjecture 1, then it would imply conjecture 2. Okay, because you start out with some surface that has some entropy, you run the mean curvature flow, and you're going to see a singularity at some point. And if you knew this, if you knew that all the entropy of all the non-flat self-shrinkers were above, and you combined it with their theorem about the compact guys, then you would have proved this conjecture here. But they couldn't show that the non-compact shrinkers are above that of the sphere. Let me put this up. So now I can state the theorem that I wanted to talk about today. It's a theorem with Shinju. So we prove that if sigma is a closed surface, of genus not equal to 1, then the entropy is bigger than the entropy of the self-shrinking two-sphere. So, I mean, the fact that we can't do it for genus 1 is a little sad, but it seems to be sort of unavoidable. While we were working on this, we learned that two other people were working on the conjecture. So Bernstein, Jacob Bernstein, and Liu Wang, so they have proved conjectures 1 and 2. So they proved. And they are really using the flow techniques. We're not going to be using any flow techniques, which maybe is a little surprising. So they proved something stronger, I think. They proved that if a surface has genus bigger or equal to 1, then the entropy is actually bigger than that of the cylinder. I mean, you could imagine that you had something like this, saying somehow that the singularity, you're eventually going to see the cylinder at some point. Or anyway. Okay, so what is the main tool? So the main tool is going to be min-max theory. So is min-max theory in this very unpleasant metric, this Gaussianly weighted metric? Okay, So schematically, what does this metric look like? Well, it's sort of like it has a sort of cusp singularity at infinity, where the cusp is very bad. So let me count the ways in which the metric is bad. So it's bad because, so this metric Gij, it's incomplete. So if you look at a geodesic going out to infinity, it has finite length. That's usually not a very good place to start your analysis, right? Another bad point is that the Ricci curvature of this metric, it approaches minus infinity as I move out to infinity. So it's sort of kind of discouraging. On the other hand, the areas at infinity are super, super small, right? If you have a ball close to infinity, it has a very small area because of the Gaussian weight. And yet it has all these other bad properties. Okay. So So we wanted to develop a sort of a variational theory to produce minimal surfaces in that metric or self-shrinkers. So that was one part of this work with Zhou. So let me state the min-max theorem that we proved. So this is with Zhou. I could say it in one sentence, min-max in this metric works, but I will write down the theorem. Let me first give some more notation. So I start out with just a map, just from the unit cube in some dimension into surfaces of genus G. In this Gaussian R3. Okay, so you should think of this as being a sweep out with n parameters. Okay, and then what I can consider is I consider the homotopy class. So I consider the homotopy class. This is the homotopy class, which doesn't change on the boundary. And the min-max theorem that we proved is if the width of this homotopy class, so the width of the homotopy class, which by definition is the infimum of the supremum of, well, I'll write it and then say what it is. So I look at all and so I look at all things in the homotopy class of the initial map, and for each one I take the largest slice, and then I take inf over all such families in the homotopy class. Laurent drew a very nice picture, it's the same thing that was sort of mentioned in Laurent's talk. If this is the space of surfaces of genus G, and here's my one parameter family, sort of going up like here, maybe it's very wiggly. We want to produce this critical point, and so we take the inf over the largest slice in the family. Here it's a one parameter. In the application, it will actually be a four parameter. But anyway, so if the width is bigger than the supremum of the boundary slices, okay, then there exists a self-shrinker realizing the width. Okay, so whenever you find a non-trivial homotopy class, you can produce a self-shrinker. So this is sort of min-max theorem. Let me give an example. Suppose I'm going to start out with a map which maps not the unit interval, but 0 to infinity into sort of two spheres in Gaussian metric. And what does it do? So it take at time t, it's just going to be the sphere of radius t. So the picture of my sweep out is, it starts out as just a point, and then it gets to be bigger and bigger spheres until it collapses to a point as t goes to infinity. Okay, so that's a sweep out. That's a non-trivial family in the space of two spheres in R3. So we could apply the min-max theorem. And what happens when we apply the min-max theorem? So we're going to produce a self-shrinker, right? So what self-shrinker do we produce? So min-max theorem produces a self-shrinker. Right? So you might think, well, you produced the self-shrinking two-sphere. Okay, but that's actually not what you produce. And the reason is we're doing one-parameter sweepouts. So when you do a one-parameter sweepout, you're only going to get something of index at most one. Okay, and we did the classification of the index before, right? So we saw that the sphere has index 4. So with one parameter, you have no hope to produce the sphere. So you actually produce. So we produce a self-shrinker gamma, and gamma is actually a plane. So sort of the picture maybe is sort of there, sort of have these little hemispheres, which are looking like a plane on a larger and larger scale. Okay, and then they sort of go out like that. And in the end, you're going to, these spherical caps contribute very little area because they occur very far out at infinity. So in the end, what you produce is this self-shrinking plane. Any questions about that? It takes a little twisting of the mind to see that there is a sweep out of two spheres where the maximal guy is very close to a plane.
I thought the plane had index 2.
Sorry? The plane is index 1. Because the homotheti preserves it and two translations preserve it, yeah. Okay, so now I can really give a sketch of the proof. So I tell you what the main points are. So proof of the theorem, the theorem about the entropy. Okay. So what is the idea? So I start out with a surface in R3 with some genus that's not equal to 1. So the first step is I associate to my surface a four-parameter family so what does it look like? So I take any t, any translation and any scaling, and I define the surface to be what you would guess. I translate the surface and then I rescale the surface. So this is a positive number saying. So this is a four-parameter family. If you've ever been to a talk on the Willmore conjecture, they have a similar family, which they call a canonical family. We're doing something very similar here. This is sort of a canonical family. Okay. So by definition, right, we know that if I look at, this is four-parameter family, if I take the soup over all of areas over this whole family, it's bounded by the entropy. Right, because in fact it's equal, right? The entropy was defined to be the soup. So the entropy controls all the areas of the four-parameter family. Okay, and so now we want to do min-max on this four-parameter family to produce a self-shrinker. When we do that, we're going to get a self-shrinker which has smaller area than this. Okay, and if we could show that the self-shrinker that we get is the sphere, then we're done, right? Because then we have the entropy of the surface bounded by the sphere. So we would like to figure out whether we could do min-max. I erased, unfortunately, exactly what I shouldn't have, which is we could only do min-max when the family is non-trivial. Right, so is this family non-trivial? And non-trivial, if you remember, meant that the width was bigger than the boundary surfaces of the four-parameter family. Okay, so I have to figure out what this four-parameter family looks like at the boundary in the parameter space. So as the translation goes to infinity, or as the sort of scaling changes. I'll erase it here. So we could sort of... So let's see what happens. So what happens when I take t go to infinity of my family? So if I take my surface and fix S, so I fix the scaling and let the translation go to infinity, right? Because the surface is compact, the area is going to, the whole surface is going to push out to infinity, and the area at infinity is very small because of the Gaussian weight. So this will always converge to zero. So maybe let me draw schematically the four-parameter family, sort of like this. So this is when So I can't draw in four dimensions. So think of each slice as a copy of R3. This is where S is equal to zero. This is where I rescale to infinity. Okay, and each slice here is sort of an R3. It's the t direction. So what this is saying is as I go to infinity in t, I converge to the zero surface, sort of no matter where. So here I'm just getting like trivial surfaces, you know, vowel folds that have no area. What happens when I take the scaling down to zero? So that means I translate the surface somewhere and then I rescale it down to zero. Okay, well, because the surface is compact, for any compact surface, that also is going to give zero. So down here, the boundary of the family is giving zeros. Okay, so the question is, what's happening on top? So what happens when I let S go to infinity? So I'm dilating where the dilation goes to infinity. Right, so if here's my surface, right, and I pick a point here and I dilate around that point, in the limit you're going to get something with zero area, right? Right. So that seems like it's true, but that's actually not completely true. Right? If I pick this point in the interior and I do it, I really will get zero in the end. But if I pick a point supported on the surface, right, then something different happens. So this is true unless the translation is actually in the surface, right? Because if I take a point, if this is my point t, so I that means I translate the surface so that point is at the origin, right? And then I do the rescaling, then I'm going to get a plane. Okay. So in which case, so if I'm supported on the surface, then I really get the tangent plane at sigma. So this is the tangent plane at sigma. At t. So again, this is hard for me to draw, but we could imagine at s is equal to infinity, I have a copy of the surface up here. And what I'm producing here, I'll keep the same color, is our planes, okay, which are tangent to the surface. Okay, anywhere else I will get zeros. Inside the surface I will get zeros. Okay. So the boundary of the four-parameter family is it has planes on the boundary, and it's detecting the genus of the surface in some way, because you see the map which takes a point on the genus G surface to the plane is like the Gauss map. Okay? So the boundary of the four-parameter family detects the genus, or sort of knows what the genus of the original surface is. And if you've looked at the proof of the Willmore conjecture, there's a very similar thing going on. Okay. So, remember, we want to do min-max on this four-parameter family. So we wanted to know whether the four-parameter family was trivial. So is the width of this homotopy class, so the homotopy class of my initial four-parameter family, is this bigger than the soup of the boundary surfaces, which are planes or zero? So that's one. Okay. So in other words, is the family non-trivial? If it is, then we have proved the theorem, right? Because so if so, if yes, right, then the min-max limit gamma, it because it came from four-parameter family, it could only have index at most four. So if you remember, there was a classification earlier by Colding-Ilmanen-Minicozzi. So this is either S2, the cylinder, or the plane. Okay, it can't be the plane, right, because it has to realize the width, and the width is bigger than one. The plane had area one. So it's got to be one of these two, and this one is higher area. So it means that it has to be bigger than that, which is what the theorem said. So everything boils down to, is the width bigger than one? And that is the sort of crux of the matter. So I have, let's see, 5 minutes left. I'll be able to explain what's going on. it's by contradiction. So suppose the width is equal to 1. Okay, then it means that I have then there exists a sequence of sweepouts that are homotopic to the original guy. So these are phi sub I in the homotopy class with maximal area approaching 1, right? With maximal area less than or equal to approaching 1. So this is just a boundary. This is being filled in with a four-parameter family, okay? And all the areas are 1 plus a little bit, right? So what is the idea? So the idea is, so here's I have my family phi sub I, where the maximal area is very close to 1. Let's consider the surface sort of, the surface also exists in the slice S equals 0. So the idea is, consider P, any P that's inside the handle body determined by the surface. So a point in the interior of the surface. So a point right inside this genus G guy. Okay, and now I want to consider just the line in the family that goes from here all the way up there. Okay, so that's a one-parameter family. So then I just consider my sweepout restricted to that green line. Okay, and what's the point? So the point is if I pick a point inside a surface, what is that green line? That green line corresponds to all of the dilations around that point. Right, so it's corresponding to a one-parameter family of surfaces. So the sweepout restricted to the green line is a sweepout of R3. Okay, so in other words, for any point I pick inside, this green line gives me a sweepout of R3, where the area is very close to 1. Okay, and that means that there has to be some slice which is very close to a plane along that green line, because it's a pulled tight sweep out, and the plane is the only index 1 guy that can occur. Okay, so what that really means is that for any point inside this handle body, we could attach, we find a plane. Oh, it's supposed to be green. So we have a plane for each point, and what that really gives is an extension of the Gauss map to the interior of the handle body. So in this way, we can extend. Because if you remember, at the boundary, we're getting the Gauss map. So we can extend the Gauss map to the interior of the handle body. OK, but what is the degree of the Gauss map? The degree of the Gauss map is 1 minus the genus of the surface. So when the genus is not 1, it's a map of non-zero degree, and you cannot fill in, just by topology, you can't fill in the interior. Right, so this degree argument, though, fails for Torii. On the other hand, the theorem is true for Torii. It was proved by Bernstein and Wang. Right, so one more sentence I'll say. This is similar to the Willmore conjecture, and you should think that the Willmore energy of a surface in the sphere is very analogous in the parabolic setting to the entropy of a surface. Okay, it's kind of like the parabolic analog to the Willmore energy. Okay, so thank you very much. I think I should stop there. Thanks.